Our last lecture of today is the lecture by Alexey Dmitriev. You see him on the screen. So Alexey is the youngest lecturer at this school.
And oh, yeah.
He graduated from the Moscow University of Physics and Technology. And then he worked for a number of years now on basically quantum optics with superconducting quantum circuits, and published several visible and interesting papers. And Alexey agreed to give an overview of the quantum optics with superconducting circuits. And we are thankful that you really did this this work, preparing this lecture in the short time slot, because we had a cancellation from one of the speakers from Google, from Lev Iofe, for a simple reason that he actually is traveling and he forgot his iPad on the travel and cannot give his lecture, which is of course great pity, but it's also a great chance for Alexey to test his didactic skills on this kind
of this is really actually for me. Yeah. So thank you very much for the introduction. So basically, it's very good thanks to Arkady that he gives such a nice introductory information about superconducting qubits. So this is what I was afraid of, actually, because I'm still learning my way to give nice and simple presentation. So, but at least you have listened to very basic physics. And okay, let me share the screen then. Topic of my talk will be the waveguide quantum optics with superconducting artificial atoms. So basically what Arkady told was the overall introduction in superconducting circuits and in circuit QED. And actually my purpose is to focus on waveguide implementations, I would say, because obviously for cavity you can do many different experiments in different platforms, but what about open space or waveguide, which is close to open space? Actually, I would say only superconducting platform allows to do, now it's already a lot of really complicated experiments. So the plan of my talk is the following. So I would try to combine telling you about some basic physics of the single atom interacting with continuum of field modes, but not only restricting to some textbook explanations, but also present you partly what we do in our lab in NAPT. So the points 3 and 4 are partly our work. And a second part of my presentations will be a kind of review of really recent achievements in waveguide QED platform. Namely, I would say after explaining physics with one qubit, I will move to a pair of qubits in the waveguide, which are interesting example of how atom interacts with by means of continuum of modes, and also demonstrate you several latest papers on how people trying to put many atoms in waveguide and what are the results, what they can achieve with superconducting atoms. Okay, let us start with just a single atom, which actually sits, let's say, in open space, and we want to answer what is the Hamiltonian of such a system. As we know, the resonator or cavity is a kind of confined system, because we have either we have single mode or we have number of discrete modes, and actually the field in cavity or in resonator is a standing wave field. But actually in waveguide, which is closest what we have to open space, we have usually a continuum of electromagnetic modes, which could be distributed spatially and also temporally. But in fact, what we want to write is the Hamiltonian field, which combines a lot of different modes. So basically we quantize continuum fields in some box, which has some finite volume, introduced the raising and lowering operator for every node, but then we kind of forget about the box was confined, and then we just count the number of nodes which could be infinitely large. Simple Saturn we can consider is two-level system. Of course, the natural atoms are more complicated. They have many levels, but as we move into superconducting circuits, we always can find examples when only two levels are important for the experiment, and Hamiltonian of atom is just a sigma Z Hamiltonian. And the simplest interaction is when atom feels the upper limit of electric field. And if you develop this classical Hamiltonian after quantization, you will obtain such interaction, which is also a case for a single mode like resonator. It is a transverse interaction when the, each mode interacts with its own constant GI with an atom. So actually, this is the Hamiltonian. It's not really very different from the case of single mode, but we have number of modes here with its own frequencies. And one interesting example, and quite simple one, which gives us, I would say, basic taste of what is what process can be described by this multimode Hamiltonian is, if we consider a two-level atom in an excited state, and we are questioning ourselves what is the what will be the evolution, so how atom actually emits field and returns into ground state. So if we slightly work with interaction Hamiltonian, in particular we apply well-known rotating wave approximation, which removes some terms which are not physically important, we will arrive to such an equation, and then we can just consider the evolution of atom field system in time under the action of this Hamiltonian. So we consider the wave function psi over t, which actually consists of two terms. First is a qubit or atom is in excited state and field is in vacuum state. And for each mode present in this open space, we have also, we will have a probability to emit one photon into particular mode of number E. And the qubit is then finished in ground state. Our initial conditions are also known. We have ground state of qubit is initially ground state is zero amplitude, and the excited state is conditions. So ground state is actually zero and excited is one, and we can just calculate evolution, and the result is very easy to interpret. What we got finally, we have the exponential decay of the excited state with some constant gamma one, and we have a superposition of single photon occupations of all possible modes with some coefficient. And actually, if we analyze the answer, we will see that this gives us the photon which is redistributed over all the modes with just the Lorentzian profile, spectral profile, which in the time domain, this will be just decay in exponent. So this is a very well-known answer, which could be, of course, checked experimentally. And of course, to understand what is the qubit behavior, you don't need to elaborate this calculation with many modes. You can just consider the noise, which you have in this open space, and then you can also obtain gamma one using the Fermi-Golden rule, but it will be the same constant. So actually, what we described here is the short sketch of the so-called Wigner-Weisskopf theory of spontaneous emission. And of course, in many situations, we don't need this plethora of modes. We can just simplify the Hamiltonian. For example, the very common case of classical driving field. If we have some classical field, which is generated by some classical source like microwave generator or something, or laser, then we it is well known that we can just remove the field operator, the field part of Hermitian space, and just stay with the qubit, which has its own energy and which interacts with this coherent field, which is classical field for now. And the constant characterizing field is a Rabi frequency or Rabi amplitude, which depends on the amplitude of the field itself and depends on the coupling double moment. The solution of the evolution of the system with this Hamiltonian is very well known also. This is Rabi oscillations, Rabi populational dynamics. The qubit will be, if starting from ground state, the qubit will be excited. Then it will be oscillating with omega frequency, and then it decays to some, not to zero, but to some stationary state, which is not shown here. Of course, in order to see this, you need not to just calculate unity revolution, but also to elaborate a master equation, which allows you to introduce the defacing and relaxation constant phenomenologically. I will show it later, a little bit more detail. Okay, now let's consider not just the absolute atom in open space, but consider the coplanar waveguide, which is well-known structure. It could be just fabricated in clean room conditions, which represents just a central line and plain ground conductors. And the field is specifically distributed in this structure. But the main thing is that the field is not confined, so it can propagate left and right, both direction. And we have actually the equivalent of one-dimensional open space. The field modes in this waveguide, actually there is a continuum of modes, and they don't have any dispersion. So linear dispersion is here. And what we want to place a superconducting circuit, which you already know about a lot from Arkady's talk. We want to place it in a way that the interaction constant is really large. It could be done by different techniques, but important is that we can do this constant really large compared to other decay rates, like non-radiative decay and radiative decay, but not in waveguide, to some other modes, parasitic modes, for example, in sample holder. And it is important that we can still drive qubit with this incoming field, which could be somehow plugged into the waveguide. Qubit interacting with this field, it also re-emits some scattered field because it's strongly coupled. And then we will see kind of interference between these two fields. This is how actually we can identify the qubit by measuring this scattered field. Okay, and how to find what is the scattering, how scattering process is happening. We can just consider the schematics of qubit. So as you probably know from previous talks, there are different types of qubit, this is not what we care about in the moment. We can just consider dynamics of voltages and currents in this planar waveguide. As you can understand, we represent the waveguide by just some pieces of inductance and capacitance from the central conductor to the ground. And then we can solve the telegraph equations, which describe the dynamics of the fields. And qubit is just plugged schematically as a point scatterer. It could be coupled either by mutual inductance or by capacitance. But anyway, what qubit does here, it just introduces some kind of boundary conditions at the point of its location, which is here x equal to zero. Actually, the boundary conditions really depend on how qubit is coupled. If it's inductive coupling, then we will see the actually the current is then equal because there is no extra current induced, but the voltage should be priced here. And the current in the case of capacitive coupling, there is the current term from the qubit, but what we finally have is just a simple relation between the scattered current or scattered voltage and the qubit's operator sigma minus, which means that qubit just relaxes and gives some field to the transmission line, to the waveguide. And actually, it could be implemented. So here you see schemes, and here you see the physical implementations on chip. The leftmost upper picture is the case of inductive coupling. You can see the waveguide with some constrictions and several six flux qubits inductively coupled to this central conductor. And also you can see the qubits with capacitive coupling. So the leftmost upper and picture and all the bottom row is flux qubits. You can see the here's four Josephson junctions and just some capacitor which allows to couple the charge degree of freedom qubit to the central conductor. And also you can do the same with transmon qubit, where you just couple capacitively one of the capacitor plate to the central conductor. And actually, this is all equivalent systems which could be strongly coupled to the waveguide modes. Okay, then what about the properties of scattered field? As I said before, we can consider master equation which describes the evolution of the qubit and under external field. And actually, the simplest case is to measure the stationary regime. Stationary regime means that qubit is interacting with the field for a long time, and therefore, at some point, we should consider the condition where the density matrix is already not changing. Where, time derivative of density matrix is zero, and from this we can readily obtain the actually, it's expressed in terms of reflection coefficient. So, scattering field, which is if normalized by input field, gives us such an relation. So, we can just measure this reflection coefficient either by VNA, vector network analyzer, which just measures the amplitude of phase of some field in ratio to some input field, or we can measure this by spectrum analyzer. But in either way, we obtain the dependence, for example, of reflection coefficient from the drive frequency. And it corresponds very well to the calculated dependence, and we can also estimate the parameters, like gamma one is radiative relaxation, gamma two is total dephasing, which also includes some pure dephasing due to flux instabilities. But this is actually not the whole field which is scattered, because here we want to measure coherent part. Coherent part means that we measure non-zero field, but, on average. But also there is an incoherent part. How can we understand that something else is here? This could be just understood if we consider fluctuations. Okay, we know that after temporal evolution, we arrive to some stationary state, but in this state, the qubit is still interacting with field. We can say that it still emits and absorbs photons from this field, and at some point, it could be in ground state. And this, for example, if at zero moment of time it's a ground state, then in another moment of time it could be correlated with the previous state. And this is what we can this we can estimate if calculating such a function, which is just the spectral density of inelastically scattered field. So we just take a Fourier transform of this correlator, and this correlator could be calculated by similar methods. So actually in quantum mechanics, if you know the solution for example, sigma minus average, then you also know the solution for some correlator. You can calculate it with not with really complicated methods. And this was done first by Molo in 1969, and what he got is the answer for this spectral density. So what is most interesting part of this answer is the side peaks, which are emerging at higher Rabi frequencies when the omega is much larger than gamma one, and detuning between drive and qubit. Actually, it also could be measured by a spectral analyzer. So for this measurement, it's not appropriate to use vector analyzer because the field is not present. The average field is zero. But if you measure the paraspectral density of this kind of noise, then you will see that it is really there. And it was also first measured by Олег Астафьев in his seminal paper. But actually, in many kinds of artificial quantum systems, like quantum dots and some other systems, it is also a matter of study. So people can measure these spectral densities. And I have even some kind of cartoon of how all this happens. So what we did first, we considered elastic scattering when the Rabi amplitude is not so large, so this field is propagating in waveguide, the qubit can excite and then emit some field, actually in both directions. And finally, if amplitude is not large enough for small Rabi frequency, we have this very sharply peaked spectra, which is in the vicinity of omega d, so drive frequency. Means that for small Rabi frequency, we have the case when elastic scattering is dominant and inelastic is very small, and inelastic scattering occurs mostly at higher frequencies. So we have high amplitude of field, and qubit excites kind of fastly and emits a photon, which are not really in resonance, but can be shifted in frequency. Yeah, so this is kind of just qualitatively explained picture of how elastic and inelastic wave scattering could be distinguished. Then let me just briefly describe for those who are interested, first of all, but maybe for others, it could be also useful how actually all these measurements are done. So basically experimental scheme consists of two parts. So the left part is what we have at room temperature or other people who want to measure. So actually the schemes are pretty similar in all the groups who measure these optical things. So for example, here, you can see the microwave generator, which actually gives us stable sine wave, and this could be then with the use of so-called IQ mixer, this could be interact with signal from arbitrary waveform generator. This gives us some known signal, which could be also microwave pulses, not just continuous signal, like from generator, but with the use of IQ quadratures, we can shift the phase of these pulses, for example, and then it goes down to millikelvins, low temperature of dilution fridge. Then it goes through a lot of attenuation. Then at very low temperature, we have this sample holder, which I showed you before with the qubit. And the output chain of lines is different because we need, first of all, we need amplifier, specific low noise amplifier, which are commercially available. And then when signal goes out to this output, we can analyze it in the same way, so we can amplify it again and just with the use of IQ mixer again, we can down convert the signal and measure it by analog digital converters. And this is what we do in our lab, for example. And one, again, the same idea of measurement is applied when we consider what effect qubit has in this field. So for example, if we have a hearing field, which interacts with the two-level system, it should absorb an emit photon every time, like Rabi oscillations. But the same we should see on the field dynamics, of course, which I just explained to you due to this interaction operators. And this is, for example, the envelopes of what we measure when studying this effect of the qubit on the propagating field. For example, well, technically this is just Rabi oscillations, but actually this is quite interesting regime because we just measure time dynamics of this field. And for example, we can measure this the dependence of such field from the tuning, and we see different regimes. So the driving pulse has different has fixed length, and then during this interaction we observe ordinary Rabi oscillations, but when we stop the pulse we have free decay, which is defined by spontaneous emission. And actually this corresponds very well with just simple calculations with this classical field, Rabi field, which depends on time. And also why this is interesting, because this could be also measured in the case of weak coupling, because actually coupling constant between some open space, maybe one ended wavelength and a qubit, could be very small. But if one applies a signal with very large Rabi frequency, you can even see the effect on the initial pulse. And actually this could be used for the measurement of the qubit. Not, of course, not single shot measurement, but average measurement. Yes, so as now I'm explaining some basic quantum optical phenomena, let me move to another interesting example of what we do in our lab. This is so-called wave mixing of propagating modes. So wave mixing is standard quantum standard nonlinear optical effect, which is known to happen in nonlinear media when, for example, you have the electrical polarizability, which is proportional to the third power of electric field. If you have some propagating wave of frequency omega, this polarization will give you some harmonic of this frequency. Here it will be the third harmonic of the omega, so the field with the frequency of 3 omega. And if you have now two waves of different frequencies but still propagating in single in one media, then medium, then we will have not only initial frequencies but also some extra fields with combinational frequencies, like 2 omega minus minus omega plus and 2 omega plus minus omega minus. And this is what called actually wave mixing, because kind of two waves are mixed and we have another spectral components which were not present in the initial field. And actually for many, for more than two waves, we also have this effect with many side spectral components. And it is very well studied in traditional optics. It is very well known that effect is really dependent on the phase matching, like if dispersion relation is sophisticated, then you need to, in order to have a good conversion, you need to phase match the wave vectors. And this is, so this is the matter of kind of classical and established nonlinear optics. But here we have single qubit, and we can think on we can think about irradiating the qubit of a couple of fields, and we can actually understand that if qubit interacts with two modes, it could also emit a field that combination of frequencies. So if we have initial signal which consists of two components, like omega plus, which is blue peak, and omega minus, which is green peak, we can in scattered field we can observe extra spectral components, like so violet and red peak on both sides of central frequency omega drive, which is typically would be which typically would be equal to qubit frequency. And actually the explanation of this nonlinearity is just this proportion, because scattered field is proportional to some powers of Rabi frequency. Rabi frequency is just an amplitude of proportional to amplitude of initial fields, and then it gives us this nonlinear effect. It could be observed just by measuring the output field by the same spectral analyzer as before. We indeed see that we have this coherent side components on proper places. So here the qubit frequency is just in the middle of these two drives, and what we see a number of side components. This is actually something which could not be studied in traditional optics, because typically it's very difficult to pick up the elastic part of the scattered field, and usually it is the elastic field. This is power spectrum which is measured, but not the elastic field. We can understand the effect if we just calculate the time evolution of a qubit under two drives of close frequencies. And actually what we see, so the top row represents the qubit dynamics on the short times when it is not really yet in stationary state, but there is some rapid dynamics. So technically the yellow line corresponds to the case of non-zero tuning between qubit and the field, central frequencies of field, but you can just take care of red line here. And the bottom row is just different time scale. So all the dynamics already is gone because we're in stationary state. But since we have this slight difference in phase, which is delta omega t, we have the, let's say, slow precession of stationary state. And this precession is exactly what we see as a side spectral component. It could be shown that this slow dynamics, which did not disappear because of the different drive frequencies, gives us this extra component. There is a question probably. Let me see. No quantum zero in the equations. Well, actually, I think it's about the master equations. And, so when it's already derived, it does not contain quantum zero, but it just contains the qubit and some like evolution of qubit of its density matrix. And the reservoir is already in the effect of reservoir is already represented by constants of gamma one and gamma two. So this is kind of, well, this is of course technically this is quantum, but the infinite number of harmonic oscillators. Yeah. Okay. We can also derive the exact expressions for these side component amplitudes, and they just not to be really long. They just correspond well to the experiment. Yeah, we have how much? Yeah, we have 40 minutes. They correspond to the experiment. This is just an example of some kind of novel quantum optical effect, which you can just demonstrate with single superconducting qubit. And we went even slightly further. We studied how the spectra modifies when we apply the pulse drive. Now the difference is that we don't apply continuous wave, but we apply trains of many pulses with some long period, and we can not only change the duration of pulses, but we can also change the delay between, let's say, negatively detuned and positively detuned drives. And this actually changed the elastic spectrum, which we observed before. It changed it rapidly, and it looks now different, because if we, for example, if we shift the blue detuned drive such that there is no overlap between plus and minus pulse, we have now only one side spectral components and waves, and all other are disappeared. And if we mirror reflect the drive, it mirror reflects the pattern. And what is also interesting is to compare this case to the case of zero delay between pulses, and we see that only one component survives, and it looks pretty the same as before, but all other components are zero. This is actually could also be explained by just qubit evolution, but there is kind of unusual thing is that we can just select a single nonlinear process out of many processes by such a pulse drive. And also thing which is really complicated for optics, but simple for our system, we can test our arguments, our understanding by slightly altering the system from two level to just three level system. This three level system with two equidistant transitions, it could be obtained from flux qubit, let's say out of sweet spot. So we just find magnetic field at which we have this regime, and then we apply a similar driving sequence. And what we now see that number of peaks is increased, which is qualitatively it could be explained easily that now there's two photons which could be stored in this three level system, but before for two level system it was only two photons. So now we have like two more extra peaks when we have two photons with omega minus. This is really interesting direction. So it could be developed for more complicated systems and for different drives. But actually, this is kind of field engineering which you can control really precisely just for the single qubit. Okay, and these were some quantum optical effects which are actually quite simple to demonstrate, but they are interesting and promising as a fundamental physical effect. And let me now move to two qubits in waveguide. So what I described before was just for single qubit coupled to waveguide modes, but Arkady already presented the part of these results, and actually this is very interesting physics happening here, because if you just place two qubits in different points of the planar waveguide, what you see is a similar picture in terms of single qubits. So when you study when qubits are different in frequency, and you study the transmission and reflection of field from single qubits, you see the similar picture of extinction, which is really large at low Rabi frequencies, but qubit saturates at high Rabi frequencies. But picture changes when two qubits are in resonance, and then the physics is really dependent on what is the separation distance between these two qubits. In the case of if distance is multiple of half wavelengths, then qubits are so the resonant field which is emitted by each qubit, it kind of fills each other, and then they have a cooperative decay constant, which is increased in comparison to single qubits. This is what actually called super radiant. So if you have two qubits, they emit faster than single qubit. But the situation is changing if separation is if it's odd multiple of number over four. This is quite interesting because now if you just technically consider the field which is emitted by one qubit, so you can see the purple or the which one pink line, which just demonstrates that there is a zero field amplitude on the second qubit if it's emitted by the first qubit. It means that there is no cooperative decay anymore, but you cannot only think about one single resonant mode of these qubits, since the waveguide consists of many other modes which can affect in a different way. And it turns out that if you calculate this effect, you get the non-zero coupling constant between these two qubits. So just ordinary transverse coupling, but it's not zero, and it could be expressed in terms of single qubit decay constant. So the maximum value of this coupling is just half of this decay constant, which is also interesting. And obviously, this could be used for some photonic circuits engineering when systems like qubits are interacting, talking to each other in waveguide in a controllable fashion. And just to confirm what I say, some other result from this paper. So we can see that this is the case of lambda over two separation. Then you have this cooperative decay, which is like increased. But for case of, let's say, non-radiative separation, which is odd multiple of lambda over four, we have the completely not emitting qubits, but with the use of power spectrum density measurements, which shows the inelastic part of scattered field, you still see the splitting between qubits, which can only be understand as an interaction between these two qubits. This is really interesting because now we have qubits interacting in continuum of modes. There also was a really nice recent work by, I think it was done in a group of Alexey Ustinov in Karlsruhe, where by Jan Brehm, who tried to couple many qubits between each other. So just by placing up to, here I think it was 8 transmons, transmon qubits in the waveguide. Yeah, no questions. Okay. So you can see this is just a clear development of increasing number of qubits. And what is new physics object here is the formation of photonic band gap. So in fact, when each qubit here is controlled individually, so you can see these flux bias lines, which are going close to the script of the transmon. It means that you can individually tune all the frequencies in order to place the qubits in resonance. And what is an outcome? An outcome is that transmission really changed significantly. For example, one qubit, this is just typical, slightly distorted shape Lorentzian, slightly distorted Lorentzian. But for many qubits, you can see the formation of this band gap and some extra collective modes of these 8 qubits, which are also depending on number. And this is a nice example of metamaterial. This experiment is actually a good example of how this area could be developed further in order to increase number of qubits and the control of each qubit, and to study what collective modes are emerging here. And another interesting, let's say, direction is to create atomic cavities with these artificial atoms. So actually there were a proposal of Kimball in 2012 when it was suggested that actually once you have single atom which is strongly coupled to the waveguide modes, you can create a so-called Bragg mirror by placing many atoms in the waveguide. And if a coupling is strong, then two atoms is enough. And actually you can place the not only atoms to form the cavities, but also atoms to be the atoms. So you can see green atom, which is here, let's say, essentially an atom, and another black atoms form the cavity, which interacts with this green atom. And so basically the theoretical analysis showed that this cavity could be really nice and strong coupling regime could be achieved. And actually this was done just very recently by another group of Oscar Painter, I think. And so what they did, they just fabricated a chip with single waveguide, which is orange line here. And they coupled many qubits to this waveguide, but some of them, they were mirror qubits, and some of them were just atoms, which placed just in field antinodes of these atomic cavities. And actually, engineering the decay constants to be just specifically in specific ratios, they were able to show the coherent interaction between these atoms and atomic cavities. And especially interesting thing is that these probe atoms, as they call them, the orange one, they interact with the modes formed by green atoms, and not just interacting for some specific with some specific state of this collective atomic system in the green cavity. So interact with dark state of this atomic cavity, and actually the interaction constant also is defined by decay constants of each qubit, and they were able to demonstrate actually vacuum radio oscillations between these probe atoms and cavity and atom cavities. And they also demonstrated that the atomic cavity is really non-linear. For example, in this rightmost bottom picture F, they just excite the cavity by single excitation, and then observe that actually the strongly that decay is changed. It means that cavity is non-linear because single excitation in the cavity really changed the physical picture. So this kind of really interesting direction, because not only propagating photons could be obtained from qubits, but also the actually confined photons which are stored by the means of another qubits. This is a really interesting direction to develop as well. And another, maybe the last one, this set of review is giant superconducting artificial atoms, which is also really recent work by a group of Will Oliver in MIT. Summarizing what they did there is they fabricated a number of giant artificial atoms, so-called. Giant artificial atoms is atoms which are just large in comparison to the resonant wavelength. So it's easy to show that real atoms, they could not be in any way large enough to be large enough in comparison to resonant wavelength. But in superconducting qubits platform, you can easily fabricate such a systems. Not only fabricate, but fabricate them in a really controllable way, and implement the coherence free interactions in the waveguide between such atoms, and actually even achieve two qubit operations between this atom. So again, the comparison of sizes, which is of natural for natural atoms like hydrogen and everything, the size is less than nanometers, but the light length wave is light wavelength is like hundreds of nanometers. So Doppler approximation will always be valid for such things. And also for Rydberg, for Rydberg atoms in highly excited state, this is also the case because microwaves also has a large wavelength, but for subconducting atoms, it's not really so far. Partly because the open space, which is waveguide, it could be somehow curved in arbitrary fashion in order to couple the qubits. Yeah, in order to couple the qubits in different points to these waveguides. And actually, this all was inspired by quantum acoustic dynamics, because considering the wavelength of surface acoustic wave, it's very small comparing to dimensions of galactic qubits. And then you can really achieve the regime of giant artificial atom. Also, it could be achieved just by making, coupling flows which go far enough and couple to the field in different points. And of course, now everything will depend on the separation between these coupling points, because the phase will be different. Phase of propagating field, which is acquired on the way from one coupling point to another coupling point, will be different. And actually, this causes the frequency-dependent coupling. You may be skipping some technical detail, just showing, for example, this this picture, when not only you can couple each atom by waveguide in different points, but also you can braid these coupling points, and it also results in different dependence of collective decay rate and coupling constant. For example, if we consider the case D, when you consider the just specific arrangement of coupling points is presented when the first point is from one atom, another is from second atom, then again first atom against second atom. Then what is interesting for this case is that you have non-zero interaction, and in the same time you have zero decay. And actually, I think collective decay is also zero, and individual decay is zero. It means that you actually can place atoms in place atoms in such frequencies when they do not feel that they are in open space, so they are not decaying, but they interact as quantum objects by just like atoms in cavity, which is quantum bus. It's very interesting, and this was actually implemented by the group of Will Oliver. So they fabricated exactly the suggested coupling scheme of two qubits, and actually, okay, not to be too long. So we can just consider two results from this paper. One is when they couple atoms which has two coupling points, and they measure the decay of this atom. So there is a point of suppression where decay is becoming longer, but there is still interaction in this point, which means that you cannot really avoid the interaction, but still you have this small decay. And actually, you can even fabricate more complicated circuit, which was done here, when three coupling points are present for each giant artificial atom. And now you have actually two different points of very small decay rate. And you have also point of small interaction rates. So actually you can switch off the interaction completely, and you can switch off the decoherence, and you can then again place qubit in resonance, and then make a two qubit gate, which is isolope gate. So Arkady just talked about C-phase gate. ISWAP is the similar to qubit gate, but slightly different. In order to make this ISWAP gate, you just need to place qubits in resonance, and then they just exchange the excitation. If one was excited and another was not excited, then this will be excitation change. And actually, the coupling constant and decay constant also calculated very precisely, depends on this phase acquisitions on the way of field propagation. And finally, they can just demonstrate that the 2-qubit gate is of very high quality, which was like 95%. This is also a promising direction for the development of this, of this hybrid superconducting qubits and propagating photonics. I don't know. So actually different to name this field, but it's kind of something new here, maybe promising for some applications. And also, just last thing to mention, actually it was after single qubit in open space was studied, was understood very in a short time, it was understood that the qubit could be a nice single photon source, actually. So this is what we considered in the very beginning, if qubit is excited, it emits the photon, but actually you can even control the emission process and totally separate the excitement field and the emission photon. So actually the optical analog of this system is just a screen with a tiny hole. The hole is much smaller than the wavelength, and the qubit is represented by this red circle, and it sits just behind the slit, and actually excited by the large classical field, which goes from the left side and then emits the photon, but on the right side, in right half space. And this is precisely what is happening here. So the first implementation was done in 2016 when it was flux qubit, which is coupled very weakly to control line, but coupled strongly to emission line. Then it could be still excited from control line because of large field amplitude. And then it emits photon in right half space with efficiency of like, I think now it's already close to 99% what can achieve. And also it could be realized with transmon, of course, not only the flux qubit, the type of qubit is not really dependent here. And system, system acts as a quantum emitter and emits single photons on demand of known shape and known profile, let's say. And actually it also was the reason of avalanche of new results for this in this era of microwave photonics. So actually just being short, so the Hohenlohe-Mandel effect was demonstrated, which is the effect when two photons coming from different directions on single beam splitter, they kind of couple, so they go to single shoulder of beam splitter. Actually, photon shaping could be achieved because the qubit could be controlled during the emission process. And it means that even the coupling constant could be changed during the emission process, which causes photon shaping. Actually, this microwave photon propagates in the waveguide, and it could be again trapped in some cavity. And even QND measurement, which is non-emulation measurement of the single photons, was demonstrated. I think by two different groups even. And also quantum communications by this single photon is possible because if you know the photon is propagating in waveguide and you can place a qubit part of this photon, and just by controlling qubit you can force it to absorb this photon controllably. And in principle this also was shown, but I just give some extra attention to this last point, which I list here. This is entanglement between different microwave photons. So this is quite interesting experiment, also recently done, I think, by a group of Andreas Volov, where they just couple two qubits. One is auxiliary qubit, and other is emitter qubit, and they couple it in a controllable way, allowing to make two qubit operations, logical operations. And this actually could be shown that doing these logical operations, so performing these logical operations, causes the different photons to entangle between each other, because these two qubits are entangled, and the emitter always emits because it's coupled strongly to the wave. Means that these many photons, they could be entangled with each other. It is even known what are the protocols, namely what types of two qubit gates and interleaving single qubit gates must be applied in order to generate known state like cluster state, GHZ state, and the WR state of many microwave photons. And actually, so long story short, it was just demonstrated that for three consecutive photons and four consecutive photons, the fidelity is quite high of this collective entangled state. So this sophisticated thing is to make a tomography of this state, because it requires some technical complications like FPGA fast processing of propagating microwaves. But anyway, it also really promising direction, because it demonstrates how actually quantum entanglement could be accessed from this paradigm. This is very promising as well, I think. So I think that's all. If you have any question, please ask. Hope it was not really difficult. Too difficult.
Great. Thanks, Alexey, for this nice overview. I guess it really reflects up-to-date situation in the field, which is rapidly developing. And actually, some of the reference I didn't see myself, very fresh. I think there is a question in the chat. Can you read
it? Okay, yeah. What is the role of waveguide? Transport quantum state from point one to point two by using linear susceptibility of the waveguide. I think it relates to experiment with probably a couple of qubits, with two qubits interacting with the waveguide. Then the role of waveguide, so it's kind of quantum bus as well, because initial experiments, they demonstrated that the cavity could be a quantum bus between two qubits. And the waveguide also is not worse, even better than the cavity, because it has many modes, and actually qubits are interacting by means of its continuum of modes. And actually, second part is to manipulate artificial atoms by generating various frequencies through the body nonlinear susceptibility of the waveguide. Well, actually, the waveguide itself doesn't have nonlinearity at all. It's completely linear. At least for the intensities we apply in order to control qubits. But qubit itself is nonlinear. It has third order nonlinearity and actually high order nonlinearities. And it could be seen in many experiments. I just example what we did with qubits, just measure mixing between modes. But actually, it could be shown not even in waveguide geometry, but in cavity, all these nonlinear couplings. How degree of coupling is achieved between artificial atoms? I think the question was how coupling is achieved. Well, coupling is achieved by means of either direct coupling without any waveguides or cavities, or by means of cavity or waveguides. So this is kind of common questions like, okay.
Well, just maybe an additional comment on that. Communication between qubits in the waveguide is possibly also alternative architecture of quantum computer. And as far as I know, there is even a large project in Caltech where the group of Painter, Oscar Painter participates there, where they have plans of building this kind of architecture So in a waveguide with band gap, one can basically park qubits if they have to be protected or sort of kept in coherent state, and then can be tuned out of the band gap and interact with each other at the edge of the band gap, really one-to-one interaction. So it's a very, very recent and very interesting development in this field.
Yeah, of course, because actually the variety of regimes is achievable in different band gap structures, of course, by means of qubits or not qubits, just cavities. It's really a large field.
Yeah. I agree. So I was more mostly commenting on the previous question. It's another question from Andrei Pankratov.
Okay, I will see. Yeah, just make a single photon sources frequency. Yeah, okay. Existing sources, I think in our platform they are based on this principle that the qubit emits a single photon. Well, the frequency is just the resonant frequency of qubit. It's several gigahertz. Repetition rates, it depends, but technically it could be very large because typical emission time is maybe 10 to hundreds of nanoseconds, and then after qubit for sure is after photon is emitted for sure, then it could be excited again. So probably repetition times is maybe one order larger than the photon length itself, and the coherence times could be really much, much smaller than radiation time. So if coherence about failure, so coherence is important in terms of quality of source, in terms of the efficiency. And efficiency, even experimentally, it is already achieved to be 99%. It could be, it is restricted actually by, not even by qubits quality, but by emission during the excitation process, which could also be improved by using tunable coupling between the qubit and the waveguide. So this is in terms of photon source, I think they're quite, they're of good quality photon source, but actually the problem is lack of detectors, because there are some works which demonstrate that photon detection, but kind of reliable and practical photon detection in microwave range, this is still something to achieve. Yeah.
Okay, thanks a lot. Any last chance in the audience to ask question for this talk, for this lecture? There is a question from
Alexa. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. It's not QBSM transmits. What about ResNet and second state of transmit?
Maybe you can read the question because...
How I have managed, you have used flux qubits and transmits. What about interaction between resonator and second state of transmits? Well, actually, if it is about our experiments, we didn't use resonator at all, but in practice, of course, resonator fills second level of transmit, and it should be actually included into consideration when you calculate the specific shift, because it has different sign from the specific shift of 0-1 transition. Of course, it interacts, and it should be taken into account in some practical calculations here.
All right.
Okay.
Okay, I see no more questions at the moment. So we all thank Alexei for this nice lecture. And tomorrow we'll continue also with quantum optics in one of the talks. It will be a talk of Kirill Fedorov in the afternoon, which will be about continuous microwave quantum optics with microwave photons. or with microwave in superconducting quantum circuits. With that, I think we can close the second day, and we thank the lecturers, Yuri Makhlin, Arkady Fedorov, and Alexey Dmitriev for the lecture of today. And we see us again tomorrow morning. So with that, we close the lecture room, virtual lecture room. Till tomorrow. Bye-bye.